Sabbath, everybody. Are you glad to be here?
Yes.
Why are you glad to be here?
Because God's here.
Because God's here, right. We want to welcome you all to Sabbath School and Church today, church this afternoon, or now. We have some announcements we need to make first. First, we want you to remember Andrea Ward. She fell and broke her hip,
femur, or arm.
Okay. Anyway, she's hurt.
It's a humerus.
Thank you. I've heard three different things now, but we'll take it. She needs prayer. Also remember Nanette. You haven't forgotten her, have you? Okay. God is answering our prayers with regard to her. Also, there's going to be a work bee for Vicki Davies at her place. They need some help. We'd like to have as many people there as possible. But before you come, give the pastor a call, because he's got some assignments to hand out. Help you what to bring to accomplish the work. It should be very fast. Okay? My blessing today, the blessing that I want to read today, is a little different. We're in the time of the end, correct? Jesus is coming soon. Amen. So I thought I'd take something from Revelation. The very last chapter of Revelation, the title is "The Time is Near." So if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to Revelation, starting with verse 7. Chapter 22, verse 7. "Behold, I am coming quickly. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book." Down to verse 10. "And he said to me, 'Do not seal the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand.'" And then over on verse 14. "Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have a right to the tree of life and may enter through the gate into the city." And verse 16. "I, Jesus, sent my angel to testify to you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and morning star." He's coming soon. He's waiting for each and every one of us. Our music.
We need all the kids, because otherwise we're going to outnumber you. So come up here and outnumber us.
And those of you who are at camp, Camp Myvidon, raise your hands. Remember the chant on Kumbaya? The guys are going to be doing a chant, so all the guys out in the congregation, follow the guys, and the gals, follow us.
Kumbaya, kumbaya.
Kumbaya, 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 kumbaya
Time for the children's story. You want to come up? And will the deacons come forward? Shall we bow our heads? Father in heaven, we thank you for life. We thank you for providing for our needs. Father, may we give back to you that which is yours. Time is short. Work needs to be done. We pray that you will be with this offering, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. You know, I was visiting the kindergarten division earlier this morning, and they sang a song in there, and it reminded me of the story I'm going to tell you today. Haru, I don't think we have any boys or little boys or girls named Haru here today. That's not a name we get here. All right. But you're not Haru. Well, that's good, because I wouldn't be telling the story about Haru if he was here, right? All right. Haru was a little boy that lived in Papua New Guinea. And he wasn't born into a Christian family at all. In fact, in the village where he was born, they practiced a lot of sorcery. They believed in demons and gods that did bad things to you, and they laid curses. In fact, his father was very angry. His father was the chief, and his father believed that somebody had done something bad and made a bad spell on him and his wife, and Haru's mother had gotten eaten up by a crocodile that overturned her canoe or something. And so Haru grew up all without a mother, and his father eventually moved closer to the coast so he could work on some of the plantations and earn some money. But he always said, Haru, when you grow up, I'm going to teach you the puk-puk, puri-puri puk-puk. That was it. That's magic, to get even with whoever laid the charm against your mother. Well, Haru had to work in the garden because he didn't have, his mother usually did the garden work, but she wasn't living. So he had to work in the garden all day. And he used to watch the other boys, and boys were excited because some of them said something about going to a school. Now, he'd never heard of school before. Any of you go to school? Yeah, some of you, it's almost time for school to start, or you already started, right? Yeah, school's about to begin. Well, he didn't know what school was, but he started seeing the boys coming back, and they were making marks in the dirt and sand, and they said those marks said things. How can marks say things? And he wondered about that. And they were singing songs, and they were talking about things they did at school, and it sounded like a lot of fun. And so one day he went to his father. When his father got home from working all day on the plantation, he said, Father, you know, the boys are going to school, and they really like it, and they make magic marks in the sand, and they say those marks say something. I'd like to learn to do that. Could I go? Well, his dad said, no. And he said it real mad. He said, you're not going there. That school's a Christian school, and they don't believe in puri puri puk puk. And you're going to have to learn how to use it to get even with whoever caused your mother's death. Well, Haru realized when Dad spoke that way, there was no changing his mind. But he was sure disappointed. All the next day, as he worked in the garden, his father was off at work. He thought, oh, man, I wish Dad knew how bad I wanted to go to school. There's got to be more than just working in the garden and learning magic and hunting skills. Boys came home, and he said, boys, come over and teach me what you learned today. And they started talking about it, but then one of them said, you know what? Your dad's gone to work all day, and he leaves before we go to school. Why don't you just come to school with us, and you get home before he does? And you can, if you work fast, maybe you get all your work done. Well, Haru thought about that. That sounds like a great idea, but I'm going to have to work really hard when I get home, because you see, Dad left early in the morning, but the boys had to walk 2 hours to school. You went to school and you walked 2 hours to get home. Didn't leave much time to do a little bit of garden work and get supper ready for Daddy when he got home. And you had to make sure you got it done, or if Dad found out, it could be bad. Yeah, big whooping. Over there, they didn't worry about whether you lived or not after the whooping. So he thought about it, and he thought, okay, I'll do that. He says, I'll see you tomorrow. Well, the next morning, Dad got up, grabbed a few things, and went off to work, said, make sure you get that garden done. And Haru waited, and he watched, and he kind of fiddled around the house a bit. And when he was sure Dad was down the road a ways, he hurried out and crept around the back of the hut. And then he darted down the trail, and there he saw the boys going to school. And he joined them, and he hurried to school. It didn't seem too long. 2 hours of walking didn't seem much to Haru. Got to school, and there they started off singing songs. And one of the songs they sang was what some of us sang in kindergarten today. Jesus loves me, this I know. And they sang it with all the gusto and fervor they could. And then they sang more songs. And then they heard stories about Jesus in the Bible. It was fascinating. He never heard such things. And then they learned to take sticks and they wrote in the sand right there under their bench. That was their paper. And they made marks, and those marks meant things, and they had certain sounds. And Haru learned to make a mark that was supposed to be his name. Wow. All of a sudden, school day was over, and they had a prayer, and they had to hurry home. And so they raced home, 2 hours home, and he got home. And now he had to really work fast. He had to go out in the garden, and he had to do a little bit of weeding, and he had to grab some taro and other stuff, and he put it in the pot, and he's cooking it. And boy, barely got supper ready, and here came Dad walking in. He smelled food. How was your day? Oh, good. So Dad sat down and ate. And after supper, Dad looked at him and said, I'm tired. I'm going to bed. Dad went off to bed. Well, the next morning, what do you think happened? Same thing. And the next. Yeah, Haru went to school. He go to school for 5 days, and then there was 2 days off. He wished they had school all the time. But there was 2 days off. Well, on those 2 days off, he knew he better really work, get through the garden. Otherwise, the garden would start growing too many weeds. And for some reason, all of a sudden, Haru was finding gardening fascinating. It's a wonder his dad didn't get suspicious. But Haru, those 2 days, Haru's out there pulling every weed, and he's hoeing, and he's digging around there, and he's carrying extra water because he wanted to make sure he got to school the next 5 days. And so the weeks started to pass. And Haru got to the point that he could sing as well or better, and he knew all the songs that the other boys did, and he was learning how to write. And then they started adding things up, counting and making marks for counting. He was excited. By the way, you know, his teacher hadn't gone to school many years either. Yeah, he hadn't made it. His teacher hadn't even made it out of 6 or 7 years of school. But he was teaching them, and the boys were excited. And so Haru would come home, and he'd work real hard and cook, and he would just sing the songs to himself. You know what one of his favorites was? Jesus loves me, this I know. And one day he was having a real hard time. The taro was wanting to burn in the kettle that he was cooking, and things were going on. And so when things would get hard, he'd start singing louder. And he was singing, Jesus loves me, this I know. He's stirring it real hard. And all of a sudden, he realized there was a shadow in the door. Who do you think it was? It was Dad. And Dad stood there listening, and he knew. So, you've been going to that school because that's the song all those boys sing, and that's the people person they talk about, that Jesus person. Well, you're going to learn to obey me. And he grabbed Haru and drug him out. Haru said, Dad, I'm sorry. I wanted to read. I wanted to write and count. But his dad wouldn't listen. He took him out behind the hut, and he grabbed a big, stout limb, and he started just hammering away on Haru, just beating him till blood was streaming out of him. And Haru couldn't stand up. And then he said, now that will teach you not to disobey me. You will not go to that school anymore. Haru could hardly get up off the ground. He pulled himself into the hut, crawled over to his mat. It didn't matter where he lay, he hurt. He could hardly sleep. So the next morning, what do you think he did? He got up and he went to school. You're right. I wish I could tell you that Haru's dad didn't find out. But for the next 2 years, it was go to school, get a beating. Go to school, get a beating. Also that he could learn more about Jesus, he could read and he could write and he could count. You know, sometimes it doesn't seem like Jesus answers our prayers very soon. But we're told that if we keep doing what's right, sooner or later, God will hear it and change things for the good. After 2 years, Haru's dad says, well, you can go to that school because I know I can't stop you. But I don't know how you're ever going to become chief because you have to practice puri puri puk puk. And no Christian can practice puri puri puk puk. But you want to know? Haru grew up, and God used him greater than any chief. He used him to spread the story of Jesus to many, many tribes, and he saved his life over and over again. You know, we can be glad that you and I, we can learn about Jesus. We don't have to get beatings just because we want to hear about him. We can follow Jesus. And if we keep following him, Jesus will work in our lives and do great things too. We don't have to suffer the way Haru did. But it's worth it if we did, because Jesus is good news for each of us. All right, you can go back to your seat.
Our worship thought is taken from the Great Controversy. The second coming of Jesus had taken place. The dead were raised. They started to heaven. Living joined them. And they're on their way back, heading home. But before they get to the gates of the city, they stop. Jesus stops them. And they all line up in a square, a hollow square around him. And he gives them harps, gives them crown, a new name, and they're ready to enter that city. Before the ransom throng is the holy city. Jesus opens wide the pearly gates, and nations that have kept the truth enter in. There they behold the paradise of God, the home of Adam in his intimacy. Then that voice, richer than any music that ever fell on mortal ear, is heard, saying, your conflict is ended. Come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Now is fulfilled the Savior's prayer for his disciples. I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, Christ presents to the Father the purchase of his blood, declaring, Here I am, and the children whom thou hast given me, those that thou gavest me, I have kept. Oh, the wonders of redeeming love, the rapture of that hour when the infinite Father, looking upon the ransomed, shall behold his image, sin's discord banished, its bright blight removed, and the human once more in harmony with the divine. With unutterable love, Jesus welcomes his faithful ones to the joy of their Lord. The Savior's joy is seeing in the kingdom of glory the souls that have been saved by his agony and humiliation. And the redeemed will be sharing in this joy as they behold the blessed, those who have been won to Christ through their prayers, their labors, and loving sacrifice, as they gather about the great white throne. Gladness, unspeakable, will fill their hearts, wouldn't it, when they behold those whom they have won for Christ and see the ones that they have gained. Think about it. People that you've influenced in your life. Maybe you never thought much about it. Maybe you never thought that anybody was listening. They'll be there. But not just them. Those that you influenced were influencing others. And they will be influencing others. And there'll be a throng of people there. People that you never knew, but knew you. Because you knew the Father, you knew the Son. And I pray that as we think about where we are in time and realize what joy awaits us, and as Jesus would say, be faithful. Be faithful. I'm coming soon. Song? Special music?
This is the first time that Echoes of Mercy is singing without Rick. Rick was our bass, and several of us are having to sing a part that we're not used to singing because we don't have him with us. So we want to dedicate this song to his memory and to the glory of God.
Turning, you will know a little fire is burning.
You will
And a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
It makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears, my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and Jesus,
let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry, and he will answer by and by. Now when you feel a little prayer wheel turning, you will know a little fire is burning.
You will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
He makes it right.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry, and he will answer by and by. Now when you feel a little prayer wheel turning, you will know a little fire is burning.
You will find a little talk with Jesus. Find a little talk with Jesus.
Find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Talk with Jesus.
Well, thank you so much. We are gifted and blessed to have so many members that are contributing in so many ways. And when we lose one, whether it's to death or to moving, part of us hurts. And but what a blessing. God always finds someone to fill in. Isn't that great? And God's story and his grace keep going forward. You know, no matter what Satan does, he can't beat God. And the great thing is that as we serve a God who, no matter what Satan tries to do to our lives, God's purpose will get done. No matter what setbacks you have, God will accomplish his purpose for you. As much as we lose and we hurt for the loss, we can take courage that God's purposes will be fulfilled. We've been talking about when God speaks in a series. For those of you that are visiting, just kind of fill it in. Been hearing, talking about, not so much to figure out, oh, how God speaks. I really hope that we, as we look at the way God speaks and what he does in these times, I hope that we start learning the type of God it is that we have. That's the most important thing. Learning what God is truly like. Some of us can know so many details about religion, so many details about biblical history, prophecy, all of that things, but if we don't personally know God, what is it? It's nothing. It's nothing at all. And so we've been working on this series of when God speaks and how he speaks and who he speaks through, but it's more to find and grow acquainted with the type of God that we have. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5, verse 18. You'll recognize it as a story in the life of Jesus, an event that happened in his life. And today we're going to be speaking about when God speaks through life's experiences. I hope that while we're going through this, the Holy Spirit will start bringing to your remembrance some of your experiences where God has spoken through the experience. Maybe it wasn't so great. Maybe it wasn't even what you that you were intending to meet God along the way, but he met you there. He did something. You see, that is what we find in Scripture as well. In Mark chapter 5, verses 18 through 20, we read, jumping into the middle of the story, Jesus and his disciples had crossed the Sea of Galilee and were met by a madman. That's a nice way of saying somebody who was demonic. And Jesus had cured this guy and sent the demons packing. They went into the swine and went over the cliff into the sea. But the man is saved. Can you imagine what that man's joy must have been the first time in years in his right mind? The demonic control, he was finally free. In verse 18, as Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who'd been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Wouldn't you want to go with Jesus? Hey, man, this is the first person I've found that freed me from these evil spirits. You think I want to go? You want to get out of his sight? If the demons listen to this man, I don't want to be anywhere without him, right? Someone once told me, Casey, you ought to quit telling stories how Jesus answers prayer and talk about when he doesn't. Here's one. Here's a situation where Jesus didn't answer this guy's request. I mean, it's a fair prayer, isn't it? God, you've done so much for me. You freed me from the demons. All I'm asking is that you let me go with you. I don't want to be out of your sight. Anything wrong with that? See, sometimes you pray prayers and there's nothing wrong with the prayer, but for some reason, God doesn't say yes. Have you ever found that? We'll get to it. We'll get to it. But I think it's sufficient to know. I prayed prayers when God didn't answer, and they were good. They were good prayers. I mean, not that my words were so great, but the desire was for good. And here this man prays it. Says, Lord, please let me go with you. And Jesus did not let him, but said, go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he's had mercy on you. So the man went away and began to tell in the Decapolis, that means 10 cities, how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed. When God speaks through our experiences, but some of my experiences, I don't want to bring them up. Those weren't my shining moments. Those weren't times that I honored God with my life. Those were dark times in my life. Those experiences were dark periods, Lord. Surely you don't speak through those, do you? Or do you? Last time I spoke here, remember Romans 8, 28 and 29? For we know that God works for the good in what? All things. Now, how many things are all things? What's not included in all things? Remember that, okay? Lord, there's some dark periods in my life. I was doing my own thing, Lord. I wasn't honoring you with my life. Do you speak through those times too? Yeah, but you don't want to highlight that. Can I let you in a little head? I go off on rabbit trails. I know guys back there are taking care of this. Those are going to be markers of what God has done. Markers. Don't forget those. Those will be points along your life's road, mileposts along your road to say, listen, here at this spot, God did. I apologize. I've been here too long. I know it. And you've heard my stories too much. But even as I'm preaching, then all of a sudden something flashes into my mind. I've told this story before about a friend of mine. He was an older gentleman than me, but got into the ministry. Curtis. Curtis had been a logger, a rough and tough logger, drinking, womenizing, all the things that his rough crowd could do. And then after he was married, he had kids and all, he was still living a rough life. And then God spoke to his heart. He gave his heart to the Lord. He got baptized and he was going to church, and somehow he felt like God wanted him to preach. Listen, he couldn't even speak decently. Well, if you think that, and that's just how he talked, right? But he studied, and the college says, God hasn't called everybody. You can study, but you know, you might want to consider something else. No. But God called him to ministry, and God gave him a place and sent him right back to the very area that he'd been logging. That's one of the humorous things that God does to the universe. You think this guy has been a black eye in my campaign and my kingdom all his life? Wait till you see what I'm going to call him to. I'm going to put him right back where he... It's like that country gospel song, Baptism of Jesse Taylor. You know? Used to be Satan's right hand, but now he's God's. He's making his mark for God. That was what Curtis was. And he got here, he was pastoring the church, and he went out. Now I've told this story, sorry. And he went out to enlist help from some of the businesses in, this was in northern Alberta. Up there they have Hudson Bay. It's not like Nordstrom's, you know, sort of down here. He went in there to talk to the manager, maybe help out in some of our community service work and all that. And he's waiting outside the office till the manager of the store could come out. And as he's waiting there, he hears a voice he hasn't heard for a number of years saying, well, if it isn't Curtis Johnson, why, the last time I saw you, we were... And he started recounting the drunken escapades, womanizing, some of the illegal behavior that they were doing. And Curtis is now there in his suit. And people hear it all over the store because this guy had as loud a mouth as Curtis did. And they come congregating. And Curtis doesn't get a chance to get a word in. And this man recounts one story, escapade after escapade. Curtis said it took him about 20 minutes. And before he finished, here came the manager, opened the door to hear what was all going on. He stood there listening to it. Now, you're supposed to go in and talk to the guy and ask him to give to some church fund after he's just heard what you've done for the last 20 years of your life. When he got done, this guy ran down. He says, so now I hear you're a preacher. What do you got to say for yourself? Curtis looked up at him and said, you know, everything you've said about me is absolutely the truth. I guess it just shows what God can do when he finally gets a hold of somebody's life. And the guy said, well, good for you, and just took off. About that time, the manager spoke up and said, hey, you know something? That's the best sermon I've ever heard. I want to talk to you. Would you come into my office? You see, God uses your experience, as dark and as hopeless as it may be. This man, this demoniac's experience had been in the clutches of Satan for so long. But God will turn around and use it. And here we are. 2,000 years later, talking about the greatness of God in this man's life. You know, God values your experience. You may be embarrassed of it. You may not be too pleased about what you've done. But you have a God that cares so much about you. He loves every part of you, that even your worst, he knows what he can do with it, and he's proud of what he can do with you. And he says, you know, that dark, dark piece of your life is only going to shine brighter when I show what I do with you. Wow. Don't believe it? I'd like to take you through a few quick experiences. In our Bible, we find, let's go back to begin with, to the Exodus experience, Passover experience for the children of Israel. In Exodus 12, verses 25 to 27, Moses is going back there. Here they are. They've been down in Egypt, slaves. Most of them had forgotten most of their religious beliefs. They might know that their fathers served this God, but, you know, when you're in slavery, you're not free to serve him the way you want. In fact, Moses is going to be charged with creating them to be lazy because they wanted to worship God. And he's charged. So they weren't given freedom of religion or expression when they were slaves. So you pretty well lost your religious experience as a slave. And God steps in to bring them out of this dark experience and time of their life. And the Passover happens, okay, is happening. And he tells them, of course, every family to take a lamb to sacrifice it, shed its blood, put it on the doorpost, because an angel's going to come by, but he'll pass over their houses when they see the blood on the doorpost. That blood represents somebody dying for them. Somebody died for us too, you know. It's by somebody else's blood that you and I are here today. Don't kid yourself. The only reason that you and I are here today is somebody got sacrificed for you. We're not here because it just happens. And so Moses tells them after this experience in verses 25 through 27, he says, when you enter the land that the Lord will give you as he promised, observe this ceremony, the Passover supper. And when your children ask you, what does this ceremony mean to you? Tell them then. It is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt, and he spared our homes when he struck down the Egyptians. And then the people bowed down and worshiped. I find this very interesting. In fact, later on, it became part of the tradition of Passover. They very often would have a child or the youngest person say, tell us what this means, okay? And they would recount in the supper or Seder, as it's called, they would recount the story of when God delivered them as a people. The only reason that we're here today is because our God passed over and saved us and led us out and brought us here. Children, those of you that are kids that still have parents living, you got an assignment. You need to ask your parents, hey, you got any good stories about how God saved our family? Do that. Sitting around and you're having a boring meal, or your siblings are getting on your nerves, ask your folks, got any stories about how God might have done something in our lives? Parents, can I tell you something? You need to seek every chance you can to tell your kids and your families what God has done in your life. Oh, but that was years ago. Doesn't matter. They need to know. Waypost, waymarks along your life. I have them. And it's good to remember. Before we talk about one or two of those, let's go on with it. All right. Then we go over into the book of 1 Samuel. You know, we sing this song, here I raise my Ebenezer. You know, remember that? As a kid, I wondered, well, who's he? You know, who's Ebenezer? Ebenezer Scrooge. What's this talking about, this Ebenezer? Well, this is where they got that from, all right? Ebenezer has a meaning to it, that word. It comes out of the story of Samuel, when Samuel was a judge and a prophet in Israel. Little background. When Samuel was growing up in the temple, even as a young man, a young boy, Israel was battling their neighbors, the Philistines. And it was an ongoing battle back and forth. But Israel was forgetting God and worshiping other gods as well. And finally, one day, there was coming a battle. And they were kind of scared because the Philistines were outnumbering them. And so the troops were getting kind of scared. So they said, you know what we need? We need God here. Now, it's interesting. Sometimes when we don't have a personal relationship with God, we start attaching divine significance to things. Stop and think about that. We start treating charms, symbols, more important than a personal relationship with God. And so they said, you know what? We really need, we're getting outnumbered here. We better get God here on our side. And so they sent off back to Shiloh or wherever the temple, the sanctuary, the wilderness sanctuary, the tent sanctuary was. Bring the Ark of the Covenant. We know that's super holy, that God is really there. So get the priest to bring it. So they call back, and Eli was the high priest. And Eli's sons, Hophni and Phinehas, and they go through the right rituals and all that, and they put the covering over the ark, and they bring it out, carry it out to the battlefield. And when the Israelite soldiers saw it, and they said, yeah, woo, and they start screaming and hollering. It says that they raised such a shout, the Philistines got scared. They said, whoa, what's that going on over there? And then the news came. They brought their God from the temple. He's there. And we know what their God has done. And they said, oh, we've had it now. Guys, you're going to have to fight doubly hard. This is it. We're all going down in defeat. So fit yourself out and fight like a man to the death. You know what happened, don't you? People learned a lesson. The Philistines wiped out the forces of Israel, and they captured the Ark of the Covenant. And they hauled it off, and they sat it in the temple of Dagon, their god. Eli is so shocked, the high priest is so shocked, he falls off of the bench he's sitting on, he breaks his neck, and he dies. His sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are killed in the battle. Now, you talk about a low period in Israel's history. What's happened? Where's God? For 20 years, well, it didn't take that long, but for 20 years, the ark never returned, we know at least, back there. It did get back into Israel. Philistines found out that having the Ark of the Covenant was no blessing to them. It started cursing, curses on them and their cities and all the rest, and they finally sent it back. And it got taken and put in a special tent beside somebody's home, but it wasn't moved. For 20 years, it sat there. Finally, the children of Israel came to Samuel. By this time, Samuel's 20 years older. He's now the judge. And they come and they say, you know, we really want God's presence. We've really messed it up. We lost the ark for a while. Man, it's been in disarray. We need God in our lives. So here we come to our text. Then Samuel said, okay. He said, 1 Samuel chapter 7, 5 through 12. We'll touch down on a number of those texts. Then Samuel said, assemble all Israel at Mizpah, and I will intercede with the Lord for you. And when they had assembled at Mizpah, they drew water and they poured it out before the Lord as part of their ceremony. And on that day they fasted and there they confessed, "We have sinned against the Lord." I've got to stop right there and say, you know, sometimes when we decide we want to get back to God, it seems like all hell breaks loose. Anybody ever notice that when you've really messed up in your life and then you decide, "I'm going to get back with God," then trouble happens? It's like, whoa, I'm not sure if that was such a good idea. Well, that's the way it is right here in verse 7. When the Philistines heard that Israel had assembled at Mizpah, the rulers of the Philistines came up to attack them. And when the Israelites heard of it, they were afraid because of the Philistines. So here you go, and your intent is to worship God. And what have you just done? You have stirred up the hornet's nest, and now you got these armies coming up against you. You didn't come out of here prepared to go to war, but now you've got a battle on your hands just because you wanted to get right with God. Verse 8, they said to Samuel, "Don't stop crying out to the Lord our God for us, that he may rescue us from the hand of the Philistines." You better start praying, because now we're surrounded. We're going to have to go. We're going to have to face them. Don't you stop praying. We need it more than ever. If we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need him. This is a dark, dark period. They hadn't been walking with God. Here they are. They just trying to get back and confess their sins to God. And no sooner they start to do this, and all the trouble they've ever had rises up against them. Drop down to verse 10. And while Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to engage Israel in battle. Can you see it? Sometimes God doesn't deliver us beforehand. He waits like he did in their history when they're pressed up against the Red Sea. He lets the Philistines come charging at them. There is no escape. It's either God's going to save you or you're doomed. But that day the Lord thundered with loud thunder against the Philistines, and he threw them into such panic that they were routed before the Israelites. Verse 12. And then Samuel took a stone. Listen to this very carefully. He took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen. Now, he didn't set it up right there. He set it up between at this another spot. I'll go back and explain why. He named it Ebenezer, saying, and this is what it means, "Thus far the Lord has led and helped us." So Ebenezer means this is where or how he has helped us. Now, the reason why he didn't set it up right there, he took it back to another spot. You know, you may not pick that up right away, but the very spot that they lost the ark, they called Ebenezer. You know why? Because that's where the stone got set up. The very spot that they had their greatest disaster, Samuel takes the stone that he took after the victory that God gave, and he takes it and he has it planted over in the spot of their greatest disaster and failure. And he calls this is Ebenezer. So they called that site Ebenezer. When they go back in history, when they write the Bible story about where they got defeated, they call that place Ebenezer, because that's later afterwards, that's where Samuel planted the stone. So the site of their failure became the marker of God's great victory. God didn't want them to forget their experience. What about your failures? When you bring God into the mix, your failures become sites and mementos of his great work in your life. Another one quickly from the Old Testament. How about the Jordan River experience? Joshua 4, verses 20 through 24. They'd crossed the Jordan. You remember how they crossed the Jordan? No, they didn't swim. Didn't build a bridge. Didn't build rafts. What did they do? Yeah, most of them didn't even get wet, right? They walked across on dry land after the priests waded into the waters. God had to do a special work. They said they walked on dry land. How do you get dry land after a river's been running over it? I think God took care of that, don't you? So right after that, they walked across the river in verse 20 and 24. And Joshua set up at Gilgal the 12 stones they had taken out of the Jordan. And he said to the Israelites, in the future, when your descendants ask their parents, what do these stones mean? Tell them, Israel crossed the Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the Jordan before you until you had passed over. The Lord your God did to Jordan what he had done to the Red Sea when he dried it up before us until we had crossed over. He did this so that all the peoples of the earth might know that the hand of the Lord is powerful, so that you might always fear the Lord your God. Ask a figurative statement question. You got any stones along your life's road? Put up any stones along there? Any markers in your life? Hey, this is where God did this. This is where God did this. You know, I look back on life and I'm starting to get a lot of road markers along the way. The longer you live, the more stones you have set up. This is where. Carmen and I took last weekend off. We were over in the Spokane area, and it happens every time. For those of you that know Spokane, you can drive through on the interstate, but one of the main roads of Spokane proper is Division Street, where it heads north. Always happens when we happen to go up Division Street, and I start coming back down toward the interstate. If you look up on the hill above in front of you, here is Sacred Heart Hospital. That's one of those markers in my life. Happened again. 62 years ago, I'm a 7-year-old boy. My dad is in Sacred Heart Hospital. He's got cancer. They're just experimenting with cobalt treatments that time. I couldn't go in and talk to him in person, even. Later on, he would die down in Walla Walla General Hospital. But remember, two visits, twice we traveled up to get up to see my dad. I could talk to him through a glass from two different rooms. I remember those trips. 7-year-old boy wondering, God, please heal my dad. And then realizing he wasn't going to get healed. Wondering what life was for me. No dad. Every time I go down Division Street, I look at Sacred Heart Hospital. And you know, it hits me. God says, Casey, 62 years. What have I done for you in the last 62 years? Have I been a dad to you? No, you didn't get your prayer answered. That was a dark time in your life. But have I taken care of you? I think of, as I go there and remind myself what it was like, 7-year-old boy, and I look, and I remember coming back to that. Later on, coming back, doing a field school in evangelism in the seminary in that city. Other times that we've come through that area, I look up there. Later on, Carmen would be a patient at Sacred Heart Hospital. Come back. Casey, I brought you through here many times. Have I heard your prayers? What am I to you today? See, that's one of those stones in my life. I get more and more of those the older I get, you know? I can't always go back to them, but they're there. I am glad that my grandparents marked some things in their life. when we were out and going to the University of Wisconsin in Menominee, I was able to look at some of the stories of my grandfather growing up. And near Rice Lake, Wisconsin, which is a little ways from there, his parents had homesteaded, my great-grandparents, when a great fire came through. Grandpa tells about it. He was just a little boy. They'd gone to town. He's coming home on a team, in a wagon. He saw a great cloud of smoke. You know, we know what forest fires are here. Fire is racing toward them. He races home. They get the kids and get what they can out of their log cabin. And there's no water near around. There was just a wet area where it was kind of a little spring in the ground. Wasn't much water coming out. So they take the kids, they take the family, they race down there, and they try to, with their blankets, they put it over the children, and they pour water on top of the blankets, and they're trying to scatter water around them so they have a space of wet ground between them and where the fire is coming. And finally, there's no more water to scoop out. And the fire and the heat is coming, and the smoke is coming. And Grandpa says he remembers his parents, his father crying out, "God, you're going to have to save us. Save me and my children." At that moment, he looked down, and here was plenty of water. And they grabbed the rest, and they were bailing water on them as the fire came. The family survived. That's another one of those spots. I wouldn't be here today. Happened in my grandparents' life. I wouldn't be here. My grandsons wouldn't be here. God set up an Ebenezer stone. Over and over again, there's spots along the highway of life. I told the story of when Kim and I were, I was helping her sell produce, and she picked produce in the early mornings over in Minnesota. Getting up 4 o'clock in the morning, heading over to an area about 30-40 miles away from us to pick corn and all the produce. She would sell it off of our truck during the day. And the time we saw it, when it was still dark, remember turning, coming and driving a road through these cornfield areas and fields, and I saw the lights coming around over the hill on a long, big curve. I don't know why. Well, I do know why, but I didn't know why then. You couldn't tell as the car was coming, but somehow, and I was hurrying to get us to work, and somehow I just had the feeling, that car's got to be on the wrong side of the road. I don't know how I would think that. It wasn't like you were looking down this way. It's on a big curve coming around. That car is coming on the wrong side of the road. And it was so strong, I started slowing down. And finally, right at the last moment when it came around the corner, he was on the wrong side of the road. It was all I could do to steer our pickup off of the road and literally put my left tire out there just on the bare edge of the pavement. The guy came by, speeding by, almost knocked the mirror off of my truck. I always remember that corner. That's another Ebenezer. Thus far has God led us. Thus far. You know, it's important. He values those experiences, and he wants us to recount them. In fact, we are told, in the Old Testament, they were told, tell your children. Tell your children. Why is that so important? Let me share with you the whole point of this sermon now. Let's go to Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 and 11. The power of an experience and your testimony. There's spiritual victory through it. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, now have come salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. Now has come. What's going on here? For the accuser of our brothers and sisters who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. They triumphed over him. How? By the blood of the Lamb and by what? The testimony, their testimony, the word of their mouth or their testimony. There's power and there's authority that is brought to bear into this whole experience. And we overcome Satan and his kingdom by the blood of Jesus and by the word of our mouths, our testimony for what God has done. There's power in your testifying to what God has done in your experience. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 makes this point even greater. Paul says to us in through Romans, if you declare with your mouth, with your what? How do you use your mouth? To speak. You don't use it to see. You use it to talk with. So he says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are what? Made right with God. Right, justified. And it is with your what? With your mouth that you do what? Profess your faith and are saved. Is it important that we share with our mouth our faith and our belief in God? Okay, so you're testifying to God and his goodness and what he's done in your life is part of the experience of salvation. And it's with that that God uses it to overcome Satan and his accusations against you. Now, I know that not all of you are members here, so you can look over our shoulders. I'll do this once in a while. Just look over our shoulders. I'm not preaching to you now, right? You can look over our shoulders. But some of us that are members here, does our church, I'm speaking of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, ever have anything we emphasize like about judgment? Do we talk about judgment? Is that part of our message that the hour of his judgment has come? Well, if you want to overcome the accuser, your prosecuting attorney, seems to me we've just been told something about how you overcome him. It's not all an exercise in mentality and thinking, but it's also an expression of your mouth. If you're going to court and you want to overcome your accuser, and they say, it's absolutely imperative you give your testimony, are you going to say, oh, no, I don't have to do that. I know I'm innocent. Well, I know this. No! You're going to say, I'm willing to, where's the Bible? Here I am. I want to testify, right? If that's what it is to win the case, to put down your accuser, you're willing to testify. And the Bible is saying it's your words, your testimony. By the way, someone once said there's no testimony without a test, right? It's your experience that you've gone through. And your testimony has to be personal. It's not about something you've read. It's not about something they taught me this and this is what I believe. See, sometimes we've made the gospel into this mental list out here. The gospel has to do with the testimony of what God is doing in your life. And if you don't have a testimony of what God is doing in your life, you do not have the eternal gospel. I'm sorry. Sorry, it's that serious. Why would I say that? Well, let's take a look at our Bible writers. 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. The Apostle John writes, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at with and our hands have touched, we proclaim according to the word of life. The life appeared and we have seen it and testify to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life which was in the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard. Is he talking about something somebody else has done?
No.
He's saying, listen, what we're talking about here is what we have seen, what we've touched, what we have experienced. This is personal, and it's the eternal word of life. We're going to read about what's this eternal gospel. By the way, the eternal gospel is you telling what God has done in your life. That's the ongoing eternal gospel. Gospel means the good news. Good news is not just a set of beliefs out here. The good news is that God is still alive and he's still saving and he's still taking wretched sinners like me and he's coming into my life, forgiving me of my sins, and he's turning me around, and he can do it for you because he's done it for me. That's the gospel that has to go out to the world. All these doctrines and beliefs only become the gospel when we bring them into a testimony of how God has used his grace to touch my life. Some people out try to go out and give the gospel without ever really telling what God is doing in their life and how good he is for them right now. You've just divorced the gospel from its setting. Jesus kind of brings this into view, very same thing into view. You know, Nicodemus came to Jesus and I want to figure out what's this gospel? What is it you're trying to tell us? You know, you're a great teacher. But I want to figure out a little bit more about what this is you're talking about. Jesus speaks to Nicodemus, verses 3 through 13. Sometimes we go to verse 16 and 17, and we don't read the first part. Jesus speaking to Nicodemus says, verses 11 through 13, "Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify of what we've seen." Now, who's this we? Well, he's just got done talking about the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit does. And so he's saying, I'm telling you, I am the Spirit of God. We, he's speaking of divinity here. And he says, listen, when I talk and I proclaim, I teach what I've seen and what I know. And the Holy Spirit does the same when it comes to us. So the testimony that Jesus is giving is about what he's seen, what he knows. He's saying, listen, when I'm talking about God and about heavenly things, I've been there, I've seen it, I know it. Okay, he goes on and he says, I've spoken to you. Oh, he goes, but still you people don't accept our testimony. I've spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one's ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. In other words, he's saying, listen, where did I come from? I came from heaven. I'm talking to you because I know I've seen it, I've experienced it. That's what Jesus is talking about when he says testifying and proclaiming. That's what John is saying when he says, I tell you what we've seen, I've touched, I've heard, we've handled all of this. That's what it's about. Jesus tells the disciples, verse 24, chapter 24 of Matthew, verse 14. He says, and this gospel, what is the gospel? Gospel means the good news, the great news. Great news about what? It's about Jesus, about God and what God has done. This gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. The gospel is the good news about God that we have seen, we have experienced, we know, we testify about what we've seen. Secondhand testimonies are no good, right? The power of God is in the testimony of what he's done for you in your life. You want to continue by the way, again, church, we talk about three angels and their message. And we say, you know, first angel's coming, and he has the eternal gospel, the everlasting gospel. What's the everlasting gospel? It's not a list this long of things we assented to. The everlasting gospel is what God has always been doing and is doing, and I testify to what he's done in my life. The reason it's an everlasting, eternal gospel is because all through history, your God and my God have just been touching our hearts and lives and changing us. He's been reaching into my heart and my life and saving me, providing for me. And it's an eternal gospel because it's ongoing. And the way you keep it eternal is you too are pointing out the stones along your life's road. Thus far, he did this. Look what he did for me. Look what he did for our family. Look what he's done. He's eternally God. That's the eternal gospel. The only time that it starts getting into that is when he's used those beliefs in making my life a blessing to myself and others. The core of the gospel is all about what God is doing for you and for me. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. Paul says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel." Now, this brings it home. Gospel is not this set of 28 beliefs even. The gospel, he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's what? The power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. First to the Jew and then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. A righteousness that's by faith from first to last. The gospel. It's about the righteousness of God and his goodness to us. Now we'll go back where we started. Let's go back to the demoniac and that unanswered prayer. You see, the disciples weren't the first ones to get the gospel commission. Stop and think. Jesus has just done something wonderful for the demoniac, just like he's done it for you and me. Demoniac is enraptured with this man. Look what he's done for my life. I don't want anything to separate us. And Jesus turns and gives him the gospel commission like he gives the 12 disciples later and like he's giving it to you and me today. Now you're the demoniac. I am. Jesus has done stuff for us. We don't want to be apart from him. We don't want him to get out of our sight. Jesus, let me get into the boat with you. Just take me home now. You don't know how many times when he's done something in my life and I said, God, everything's right. Just let me die now. Come on. I know I'm going to screw up. I know I'm going to mess up in my life. Just take me now. And he doesn't. He says, no, you can't get into the boat. Can't cross the Jordan, as some people would say. Go home. Go tell what I've done for you. As Jesus was getting into the boat, Mark 5, 18 through 20 again, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him, but Jesus didn't let him, but said, go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you. So the man went away and began to tell the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed. We're told later when Jesus in scriptures that when Jesus returned, a great many people came. That demoniac had an Ebenezer stone. Hey, right here. I used to live out here in these tombs. scared the living daylights out of everybody that came this way. I broke the chains that nobody could buy. I couldn't even control myself. One day, Jesus came. Gave me my sanity back. Took away my guilt. I wanted to go with him, but he said, go tell everybody else. Hey, I just want you to see. Look, you don't have to be afraid of me anymore. I've got a family again. I've got children. I've got people that love me. I've got a home. I'd lost it all, but here I am. Happened right here. Jesus. If you get a chance to see him, let him in, because boy, does he clean house. And it feels so good to be free of all that crud. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world, and then the end shall come. That's why a little lady 100-some years ago wrote, the message of righteousness by faith is the three angels' message in verity. Three angels' message we've talked about, many of us. It's about what Jesus has done for us, for crying out loud. Nobody else, nothing else in this world can do what Jesus can do. So why should I worship anybody else? Why should I credit anything else? Let him be the Lord of my life, because every other way leads to death. And the world needs to know the gospel. And your life and my life become part of the gospel. Don't let it die. Don't let it die. Set up a stone along the way. If you can't set up a visual stone, you set it up by telling the story over and over. Till everyone says, oh, here comes that guy that Jesus did that for again, right? Let you be the stone, the Ebenezer stone. This is how far God has led me to be. And when they tell the stories of your wicked past, you can say, I guess that just goes to show what God can do with a man or a woman like me. And now, Lord, may you bless your people. May your blessing rest upon them. May those who are sick, who are suffering from illness, Lord, may they hear your voice speaking comfort and healing to their hearts and their bodies. May those who have lost loved ones, lost homes, Lord, may you give them your assurance that you will be theirs. And they will have everything they need as they trust you. You will open doors. For those that, Lord, we look back and we realize there's times in our life we really, really messed up. Lord, give us the assurance that these are simply waymarks of where you and your grace are going to have a testimony to the goodness that you have for us. So walk with us today. Guide us safely till we meet again. And Lord, someday we want to be with you and share our testimonies again, this time at your feet, in Jesus' name. Amen.